You're listening to Cotton Tales Podcast, part of the Silicon Valley Black Project, which produced the documentary film, A Place at the Table, about the Black pioneers of Silicon Valley. This documentary film, featuring African-American professionals, entrepreneurs, technologists, and engineers from the past and present. Today, my guest is... Today, we are talking to Teresa Isaacs Thomas, former Group Human Resources Director at Abbott Diabetes Cares in Alameda, California. Teresa has held many upper management positions in corporations throughout Silicon Valley. She makes her home in the Bay Area and is sharing her life experiences with us today. How does it feel to be a retired person, and who is Teresa Thomas right now?
Well, you know, Kathy, I thought about my long-term career because in actual terms, I started babysitting in a business at 10 years old. My first job was as a waitress in the officers' club in Japan at 15. So I'm tired. And I just want to congratulate you, Kathy. You are a role model to a lot of us in terms of retirement for all the important things you're doing, particularly the African-American achievements in Silicon Valley and your partnership with Stanford University. It's awesome. And so I'm just delighted to support any of your endeavors.
Oh, why, thank you. Thank you. But you mentioned you worked in a club or a restaurant or something in Japan when you were 15. So how did you get to Japan?
Okay, well, my family was a military family, and we lived in four countries in four states and in eight cities all by the time I was 17 years old. It started with my parents getting married right out of high school and my father joining the Air Force so he could, in fact, marry my mother at 17. And they moved to England. That was his first assignment. And so my sister and I were born in Cambridge, right outside of London. And my brother was born in California, but from California, we lived in Germany, we lived in Japan, we lived in South Dakota, Massachusetts, Texas, as well as California. And on top of that, my parents, interestingly enough, since they both grew up in the same neighborhood that their parents and their parents' parents grew up, we always lived off base and we traveled everywhere. My father and mother would rent a VW van or bus, and we would go places like the Eiffel Tower in Paris when I was little, as well as to Dachau, a concentration camp. So they really shared everything with us. We traveled extensively, even in those places. But for me, it was always an adventure. I loved every minute of it. I felt, even though it was sad to leave your friends that you made over the last 3 years, we moved about every 3 years, I always was looking forward to the next place, especially those places outside of the U.S. Unfortunately, my siblings, especially my younger sister, didn't see it as such. They perhaps were not as comfortable as I was making friends quickly. You know, I was always a bit of a precocious young child, and, you know, I certainly loved meeting people. We embraced all cultures. My parents insisted we live off base. So our first trip to Germany, we were going to a German Sunday school, and didn't understand anything for the first year or so, but we finally got it. So I also learned languages. I was fairly proficient as a kid in Germany and learned the language in Japan, Japanese. I took Spanish. So my father and brother and I are all linguists. We love language and especially connecting with people different from us. And so that really shaped, I think, my future career because my diversity efforts were a big part of what I did on top of other things. But for me, I always understood because of our background, how to embrace difference and how to respect culture and how to learn the language and how not to be an ugly American as many can be when they expect people in those countries to cater to them. So, you know, when I think back about what I learned, some of the skill sets that I think carry forth through today, primarily was adaptability. I mean, we had to get up and go. We had to move into a house. My mother was 24 with three children, moving to Germany by herself while my father was already there. And so we were all adaptable. We knew how to pack fast and move. You know, I also learned, and I didn't know if I called it that at the time, but how to make connections with all sorts of people. You know, it was more than just being friends. It was really embracing people for who they were. And my father and mother did the same. We had Japanese friends. We had German friends. We had French friends. And that carried forth through both of their lifetimes as well as mine, because I traveled around the world on my own pretty extensively as well. So connections is something that I know, even in my last job at Abbott, and we'll get to my job, people always called me the connector. And so I really kind of focused on how, where did that come from? And I believe it's that we were focused, we had fortitude, we had to wheel and deal. And I think that also instilled in me a great sense of confidence in who I was, because if I can adapt and wheel and deal as a kid living all over the world, I felt like I could do anything. And fortunately, even though I was going to dependent schools on bases with small numbers of people, like in my Japan, it was my high school was from ninth grade to 12th grade, 100 kids. You know, I had great teachers that identified quickly that I was really academically inclined. I was curious, and I had intellectual curiosity. And it was because of a teacher in Japan, my high school English and history teacher, who insisted that I apply to Stanford when he knew we were coming back to Travis Air Force Base for my last half of my senior year. I really didn't know anything about Stanford. I wanted to go to school where my friends and Travis were going. And when I got a full scholarship, my parents said, hell no, that's where you're going to go. that led to me having a life-changing experience at Stanford. It was very different from what I had ever experienced. I wasn't really aware of the prestige and the academic excellence, but when I got there, I quickly retreated a bit. It was very surprising to me. For my first 6 months, I believe I lost some of my confidence because I was interacting with kids who had gone to all these private schools, knew all about art and drama and movies and so forth. And so for the first 6 months, I was not quite myself until I realized, after I got a lower grade on my class that I was majoring in, I better stop. I said, you're only here to compete with yourself, Teresa. You're not here to compete with these other kids. And your experiences alone are invaluable and unlike many others. So I quickly got over that, and I had an amazing experience there. I also had to work when I was in school, so part of my scholarship was work study. So I started working my freshman year for 10 hours a week up through 20 hours a week my senior year. I had a car accident in my senior year where I fractured my spine, and I was out for a quarter. And so I was desperate to make sure I graduated on time, and this was my second quarter of three for my senior year. But I did graduate on time, and I ended up with a 3.8 GPA. So I was very delighted, and delighted so that I ended up working for Stanford for 3 years after I graduated.
Yeah. What kind of work were you doing for Stanford?
Well, my first job was in the Career Planning and Placement Center. I was an assistant director focused on coaching and counseling undergrad students who graduated in liberal arts degrees, like me, psychology, and certainly for those kids with English degrees or other degrees, philosophy that didn't necessarily translate to a professional job other than making things, it was a very interesting experience. One of the things that it helped me do through my ability to connect with people was to identify all sorts of companies. And I've actually had a partnership with a person that we had the first career fair at Stanford when I worked there. And we had probably some 50 companies from all over the Valley, Silicon Valley, show up. It was really wonderful. And it allowed me, obviously, to build a network. Now, my second job outside of at Stanford was as the assistant dean of admissions. And I was working with a team to admit undergraduate students where I traveled all over the country to schools and kind of recruited and identified students that had the potential. You know, I had a real focus on students of color. When I was a student there, I forget to tell you that I started with another student, the Black Recruitment Orientation Committee, where we had the first group of students that were accepted. And interestingly enough, not all students of color, especially Black kids, were necessarily interested in coming to Stanford because they didn't really know about it. Much had probably some of the trepidations I had. But we brought them on for a weekend. We had them spend the night with students. We had faculty and staff involved. And that's going forth today, this, that very effort that's now extended into a week-long activity, et cetera. So those are two lasting legacies that, you know, I'm really proud and didn't realize it until maybe 10 or 15. The work I had done at Stanford, which really led to my first professional job, which was at Hewlett-Packard in human resources. I started off in staffing and recruiting. And interestingly enough, it came through my connections because I had met some leaders, including Ken Coleman, who you know, obviously, and Carl Banks, who both interviewed and selected me for a position, which was really pivotal for me because it allowed me to understand the work I'd done with the Career Planning and Placement Center and my psych degree. Although I was interested in clinical psychology for with children, you know, I wanted to work, but it was a natural fit for a human resources career, you know. And in terms of my career, but I worked for Hewlett-Packard, for Apple Computer, for Genentech, for Pacific Gas and Electric Company, for Charles Schwab, for Catalyst, which was a not-for-profit based in Manhattan, focused on women executives with Fortune 500 companies. And I worked my final job in-house at Abbott for the last 14 years. In addition, I was a consultant for about a year and a half to two when I had breaks in between jobs, try my hand on it, in the area of EEOC investigations for BART and many other companies, as well as diversity programs and executive search. I worked for Yahoo, BART, and a number of other companies as a consultant. But I found that because of my love of affiliation and my desire to work with teams and with people and see things in place that take root and hold, I realized that consulting wasn't really for me. And so I went into Abbott, where I had a global HR, the global HR business partner, and worked in several functions, sales, marketing, regulatory affairs, R&D, quality, manufacturing, and medical and scientific affairs for the 14 years I stayed there. And I had a global role in that. I supported our efforts in the UK and in Ireland. I traveled pretty regularly there. I supported the vice presidents of those functions and their teams as an advisor and coach and implemented strategies to help them build and get the most out of their teams. So it was a daunting task because prior to Abbott, I worked in central functions like diversity or training and never quite closely with leaders. And while I had my love of diversity still in me, the person who recruited me was an African-American woman, VP of HR, said, you can still leverage that in working with these leaders. And I found that she was absolutely right. I felt like I had more of an impact and I could, you know, really help leaders understand the value of diversity and how to be equitable in their treatment of all employees. So it was a really exciting experience. Although the first day I got there, I almost thought, oh, I really hoodwinked them. I haven't done this role before. But what I realized after I started going is that all of my preparation up until then prepared me for that. Yeah. And, you know, I'm glad to say when I left, I had big parties and people really relaying their appreciation for all the support. I still get calls from the day. I'm trying to tell them I don't work there anymore. But you know, I have a natural ability to kind of connect with people and talk real to them, give them straight feedback, but still be supportive. So it was just the most excellent way for me to retire from that company with that those experiences that I had. I'm really grateful that I had them.
One of the things that I heard you say, and I've heard it said before, particularly with those people who are promoted in their mind above their pay grade, and then all of a sudden they find out they have all these fabulous skills that they've learned along the way. And say, if I asked you to go back to talk to Teresa when she was at Stanford, what would you tell that young Teresa going forward?
Well, I tell her the same thing I told myself when I was at Stanford about, I'm not here to compete with anyone else. I'm here to do the job the best of my ability. I know when I put in all of my effort and focus, and I'm satisfied with the results. They may not be always best, but I know I put my heart into it, and I learned from them. You know, so I wasn't there trying to pretend that I knew all these things that other people may know. I knew what I knew, and that's what prompted me. And I think the feedback that I was getting from the leaders really surprised me, because it just reinforced that I was in the right role, you know, and I think one of the things I learned through those 14 years, especially coaching executives, is I'm not there to be your friend and to tell you what you want to hear. I'm there to earn your respect because I'm telling you what you need to hear in terms of avoiding risk and leveraging talent and developing succession plans, and really paying attention to diversity and whatever else is important. And so that became something that I became really proud of, because I realized that, you know, I'm not afraid of anybody. In fact, there's a story, one of the head of sales and two of his top leaders were speaking with me over the phone about wanting to get lay off or fire a person who'd only been there a couple of months. We had a process in place where you gave people, went through a performance management process, so that we knew we could stand up and look ourselves in the mirror and pass the red face test. And so they were yelling at me, and I said, look, you can do what you damn well please. This is your decision, but I'm telling you, my advice is this, but let me ask you a question. If you were standing before a judge and they asked you, why didn't you follow your process as you have for everyone else, what would you say? And they just backed down. Then, oh, it was the HR stuff. And one of them, subsequent to that, has said to me, Teresa, you were really tough. That you had all three of us on you, and you didn't back down. I said, I'm not afraid of you guys. And so that's kind of the attitude I adopted, that I know what I know, and I've been around, and I'm here to negotiate, because I was not the kind of leader, and I think this should be true for any role, to immediately say no. I learned to say, if I didn't think it was necessarily the right direction, I'd say, let me think about it. But here are some of the implications that I'm concerned about. But let me think about it. And if I waited a day or so, sometimes options would open up in my mind that I had not considered, because I was going straight for the no. And that's what I think earned the respect of leaders, that, you know, I'm not there to be the HR police. I'm there to help you figure out what you need to get done in the best way that makes the most sense and will keep us out of trouble. And so I think in any career, and any leader should be able to stop and think and listen before they come forth with a solution, because you won't understand how the solution will work if you don't think about all the implications.
You know, I found that working in Silicon Valley, the impression some of the companies had was that HR was there to give the company picnic and the company Christmas party.
Right.
But very little should come from us other than what they would desire. In other words, if they wanted to break a law and hire someone who wasn't a citizen, it was our job to make sure that that person got a job, no matter, we had to break rules, whatever they wanted.
Right.
And so consequently, later on down the road, many of these companies got into trouble because they were not following the letter of the law. And I found that the HR department was failing at doing the job that was required of them. In fact, when I worked for a consulting firm that we did HR training, human resources training, and I gave the example of HR is that middle person that plays both sides of the law. the side that the company should be aware of and the side that the persons who are working for them should be aware of. So in other words, labor law on one side and corporate law or whatever on the other. So you have to, you're right down the middle. And so you have to keep both sides out of trouble. And that's kind of the role of an HR person, not necessarily to give the company picnic, but to actually know the law well enough to know how to keep them out of trouble.
And I think that that's an excellent point, because the first HR leader I worked for at Abbott, you know, I didn't consider myself an HR leader. I considered myself a business leader. So whenever I went to the boardroom or went to meetings with all the bigwigs, I'd sit right down at the table and I would ask questions from a business perspective. And so I knew it was important for me to learn the business, know the question to ask, and be willing to ask them. But also, more importantly, is the willingness to say no and stick to it. Mm-hmm. And because I was seen as a business partner, in fact, some of the leaders said, you know, they don't, you know, Teresa's not an HR person. She's one of us. And that was music to my ears, especially when those same VPs and leaders called me for advice, because they saw me as one of them.
Yes.
And I think too often HR people, at least in the past, have been reticent to say no, have been reticent to see themselves as a business leader instead of the HR person sitting over in the corner of the room. Don't sit at the table. They're not visible. They're not standing up. And for me, visibility, I always look at it, I'm going to be visible anyway. I'm an African-American tall woman, and I'm going to walk into a room and they're going to notice me. I always use it to my advantage.
Yes.
And so I would go right in and sit right down and start talking. Now, and I wasn't one to talk just to talk, because that's the other thing, or to talk just about HR stuff. You know, we would talk about the business and how can we do this to accomplish this business goal. And that was an important lesson, that as I talked to anyone when I was coaching employees, especially people of color or even women, because, you know, we haven't necessarily had the floor.
Mm-hmm.
We don't necessarily... Some people want to fly under the radar and just do their business and sit, you know, by the side of the door. And I said, that's not going to get you anywhere. In fact, those are the first people that get laid off, because they don't see they're not seen as committed and as tough to be able to really have a point of view. And that was one thing. I said, what's your point of view? You have to be willing to listen, but have a point of view. And you can't sit in a meeting every day and not say a word. I coach my own team on that.
Good.
And in fact, I sit in on meetings and I sit by him and I start making a little motion so he knows it's time for you to speak up. and he was an African-American young man. And today he's an associate director at a company working from his home in South Lake Tahoe that he just bought with his wife. And he really appreciates all the coaching and support I gave him. So you're right, Kathy. We have to get away from that thinking about I'm just HR. Now, I understand the human resource implications of decisions, and that's where that was my sweet spot. So if we're talking about business, then I'm the one to say, okay, let's think about this from from your people standpoint. How does that play out? You know, so that's different than just going and saying, no, well, we have to roll out this program, and you know, we'll have the picnic, and I'm going to be quiet, and I'm just going to talk about HR stuff.
Yeah, unfortunately, that was the impression that they had. It was very hard to establish the HR department. And what we saw happening in the late 2000s was this remote recruiting wasn't attached to the company at all. Same thing with their interviewing and the appraisals. Why are you handing off these essential human resources functions?
Right. And consultants. And, you know, Abbott was unique in that, first of all, it's a 99,000 person company. It was larger than that until their pharmaceutical division spun off. But they had a centralized function out of Chicago, which were all the functions like training and development, compensation, benefits, employee relations, and recruiting. Now, we would have recruiting teams at our site, but they rolled up into that. And then our work as business partners was to do none of that. We weren't transactional. We were really there to advise and guide and counsel and then implement programs that, as as a company, we needed to. And so it was a different model. But I know that companies have gone back and forth from a centralized or decentralized HR model.
Mm-hmm.
And it just depends on, you know, the cycle we're in. But I think Abbott, that worked well because I was tied to the business leaders. And I went to every one of their staff meetings. I'd meet with them regularly, twice a month, all four of them, if I'd have four functions to support. I'd go to their offsite. I would help them shape their offsite. So, you know, we had the luxury, if you will, of being a true business partner and not having to deal with, you know, what do I do about this staffing issue? I need to hire people. I said, okay, let me put you in touch with the team, you know, and then I follow up to make sure they're getting the service they need. So we were brokers of those kind of things.
Well, now, you have this language ability, my dear, that I saw.
I do?
Yes, you do. I saw you in, in fact, I don't know if you remember, but we were in Reno, and we'd had dinner at a Japanese restaurant, and you said,
oh,
the food was delicious. I'm going to go back and tell the cook how much I enjoyed their food. And when you went back there and you were speaking to them in Japanese, to the point, where, they were standing there as if they were looking at someone who had just popped in from the heavens. They had... They just couldn't believe they were hearing these sounds come out of your mouth.
Yeah.
So how have you used your language ability in your career throughout your life?
Obviously, if I'm not speaking it every day, I was 17 when I left Japan. I'm 64 now, so. Now, but what I do know is that I recall certain phrases and niceties, like how do you say good morning, hello, blah, blah, thank you, what can I help you with? And I know that in lots of different languages. Whenever I travel to a foreign country, I take a little book, I start learning because I have a knack for the, I have an ear for language to the point where people then think I'm fluent and I have to tell them, no, I'm not. But what I have found is that it creates an opportunity, an opening for that person then to see me as someone that they can relate to. And for me, it's all about that, Kathy. I guess this desire to always connect with people. Even when I can give you an example, I was in Germany visiting my brother and I was there for some jazz concerts all over in Holland and Nice, France and Montreux, Switzerland. So I caught a train from Germany where my brother lived to hook up with my friends in Holland. And on the train, there was a gentleman, a younger one, who spoke a little English or a little German and a little English. I didn't speak Dutch. So between our little English and little German, we talked for the whole train ride. And we were even talking about things like the meaning of life. And then it dawned on me that communication is so much more than just the words that are coming out of my mouth. It's really about, you know, body language. It's almost a connection mentally where you're just, you know, really leaning in and picking up what people are saying. So I've always loved it. I know phrases, you know, I'm not fluent in German or Japanese, but I can speak to German and Japanese because we had people all over the world. And I can remember at a conference where I had to introduce our speaker, it was probably a sales conference. I said hello in about five or six different languages and everybody was just clapping. But it's simple, right? You know, and it's just to show respect. And to show that I'm paying attention and I'll do what I can to just respect you and give you, you know, my full attention. So it's been a plus because once I say it, then they want to come around me and talk to me. And so I always have people follow me all the time.
Well, don't you think it says to them, first of all, that you took the time to learn their language? And
yeah.
It shows your empathy for them because if language
right.
is more than just what you say. It's what you feel
right.
about. It's almost like it's a cultural thing to you, a cultural exchange.
Right.
Just the fact
yeah.
that you in Spanish, for instance, they have different words for men and women tells
right.
you that
right.
they think differently about the two, you know.
Right, right. Under,
two sexes.
Yeah, you're right. Empathy is a great word for what it is that you can share. And it's almost a feeling that, you know, a connection in your gut is chemical. I would call it spiritual
mm-hmm.
because if you, communicate in a way that show empathy and interest and warmth and curiosity, then people connect with you on a different level that allow you then to do good things together, you know? And so I think it's a very unexplored capability that people have, especially empathy. And Lord knows we need more empathy in this world, right here in our country. Mm-hmm. And it starts with our leaders. But, you know, it's something that I've been blessed with. I still think I try to work on it, you know, in terms of just stopping and thinking about where another person stands and how it must be to them. I learned it, too, when in Japan, for instance, because we were very involved with local people. My dad was a cop, and so he would know all the police officers or policemen in the local town because, of course, military people would be going off base. And we went to a dinner at one of these cops' homes that really loved my father. And his wife served us, and she went to the back, and she didn't sit with us. And my mother was uncomfortable, wanted to get up and go back. And he said, no, this is fine. And so while it was uncomfortable, even for me at that young age, about gender identity gender differences, I learned that you have to respect the culture. And what happened from that exchange, that Japanese policeman asked my dad, would he be willing to let all of us go to his kid's school so we could talk to them, or they could ask questions, probably because they'd never seen any black children before. Mm-hmm. It was true in Germany. The German kids, we went to a German school as well with one English teacher. They would want to touch my skin or my hair at 8 and 9. But you know what I felt? I felt like I was a star. I'd hold out my hand because I knew that it was different, and they were curious and they were smiling. It wasn't like, you know, like the experience of African Americans here in this country when they're talked about for their hair and their skin color. There, I was the hit. And I used to tease my parents and say, I'm going to start charging money. Anyway, I know you'll edit that.
Maybe not. No, I know we had the same experience in England. We were there for Al had business, you know. He used to go over 3 or 4 times a year, and I'd go with him. Anyway, long story short, one of the directors there had his parents who were raised in Germany living with him. They lived out in Bracknell, out in the country. Uh-huh. So we went out to have dinner with the family, and those Germans had never seen a black person,
right.
And
right.
So the mother wanted to drive back into England with us in the car because she just wanted to look at us, you know. And finally, when she said something to her son in German, and he said, "She wants to know, can she touch your skin?" And I
wow.
said, "Absolutely, yes, she can touch
good.
My skin," because I felt,
yeah.
you know, she'd never seen anyone like me. This is a lesson for her. And what she'll
right.
find is that I'm normal. She won't be afraid
right.
the next time she sees someone like me. It was a learning
yeah.
experience for her. It was a teaching moment, I felt.
Yeah.
So, of course, she can touch
well,
my skin.
A lot of people I tell that story to, black folks, they're not that keen on me letting people touch me for that reason.
I know.
But I found it educational, and you know, I'm proud of who I am. I'm proud of my skin color, my hair. When I was in college, I would perm my hair and roll it up and go about my business. And if people ask, oh, why are you on here? I said, that's what we have to do with black hair. This is how we take care of our hair.
Exactly.
You know, you straighten yours, curl yours, we straighten ours. You
yeah.
know, there's no bones about it.
And I think that sharing, that's how you learn about each other. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I've never been understood why you feel like if someone asks you, if they're being honest and curious, answer the question.
Anyway.
Right. How are they going
right.
to know? How? Do not be insulted, because we're asking them some stupid stuff, too. But we think, oh, we have a
yeah.
right to whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
Stupid stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard them. Just to highlight, Kathy, in terms of my career, my not-for-profit experience. And it was really interesting. I think back to why was I so compelled about getting involved in the community. And it started actually when I was a junior high school student in Japan, and I signed up to be a teen counselor to counsel elementary school kids. Well, I loved it, and not only did I love it, I was good at it enough to be selected to represent Japan, or our area in Japan, at a conference in the Philippines for a month. That was, I stayed with a family at Clark Air Force Base. I was 15 years old, and going to this conference about, you know, coaching and counseling and what it means and so forth. So I think that's where my passion was born. And in terms of my not-for-profit experience, I made it clear later on in my career to companies that were interested in hiring me that, you know, this was very important to me, and I wanted to make sure that you supported my efforts. And I was on several boards of directors, as you know, the National Urban League. I was the president for a short term. I was a president of PAPA, and that's due to Harl Banks and Bessie and Ken Coleman, and I was terrified of that, but we had a good year. We did some good things. And I also was on the board of directors for United Way at Santa Clara, where the committee I was on with LaDoris Cordell, I don't know if you know her name, she's a judge, a black judge, yeah. She was the dean of the Stanford Law School, and that's how we met. In any event, but we led the effort to defund the Boy Scouts back in the 90s because they were not supporting gays and to work as Boy Scout leaders. Let's hope that didn't fast forward to what's going on with them now, but I doubt it. And I also worked with Junior Achievement, just disability organizations, Hope Rehabilitation, another one, and as well as professional associations. But I can remember a time at PG&E, the CEO wanted me as the, I was the head of diversity and EO. I had a team of about 7 people. He wanted to ask me to help his kids at their school in Orinda or Moraga, one of those, because they wanted to do a diversity day. And they had never done anything like it before. There was not much diversity, and he was concerned. So I went and partnered with the school and with the students, and I had an assembly of 250 kids, whereby I kind of went through this program that was really compelling, and I was stunned by how much they embraced it. So that became my thing. Whenever I went to another company, I'd say, okay, I need a half a day off a month to go do this training. I did it in East Palo Alto and Oakland and all over in San Francisco. And then unfortunately, when I went to Abbott for the last 14 years, I was so embroiled in that job, working long hours, traveling, that I really didn't do any of my community service work other than what we did as a company, working in some of the schools and science programs and so forth. And so as I thought about my, you know, where do I go now, I feel like I'm going back to my roots and to my passion for supporting the community, especially youth. And now with all of this, you know, COVID going on, it's keeping, you know, me, of course, at home. So it's been like, hurry up and wait. And the Black Lives Movement matter has come full force. And so it's even made me ponder, you know, instead of working just with kids, which is a passion of mine, you know, this is an opportunity for me and others like me with the kind of background I have to get more seriously involved in changing culture of organizations that need the help, like the police department. And I'm exploring how to become a part of any implicit bias training to teach policemen, because my daddy was a cop. I know cops, and I'm not afraid of anybody. I could stand toe-to-toe with a cop. And I believe there are great cops, I believe there are bad cops, but I believe it's the culture that's the issue. And we got to start with the top. And so I'm going to reach out to Libby Mayor of Oakland and other areas eventually to say, hey, I have this background. I'm interested in helping. You need a trainer. Because my goal when I retired, Kathy, was to be able to work for free to do anything I wanted to. Mm-hmm. I'm not in it for money. I don't want to work for corporate America. I don't want to be, you know, an executive coach or consultant. I want to get in the community, and I'll do it for free. So that's why I was so excited to partner with you on the Stanford archives and the, you know, African American achievements. So I'm just waiting, but I'm looking for opportunities that I can do even from my home, like this. Mm-hmm. Because I never would have imagined I'd be on a podcast.
Well, that was one of my questions: is what are you going to do next? And I think you answered it well. I'm hoping that the message gets to Oakland and to those cities that need a trainer,
mm-hmm.
That they hear you or hear of you and come forward.
Yeah, I also reached out to Michelle Obama. Valerie Jarrett and I were classmates at Stanford. She's Obama's, was his senior advisor. And she was at this reunion at Stanford last year and reached out to me. And so I thought, hey, I'm going to see what they're doing. And what the lesson is in that is oftentimes people want to do something, but they don't go right to the source. I will pick up the phone or send a text or an email to their organization and say, hey, here's who I am. I'll call Valerie Jarrett. I'll call the mayor's office. You know, you got to go to the top if you really want to make an impact. And then I think about my background and my experience. I say, who wouldn't want me to help? You know, just to put it plainly, you know, I think I have a lot of experience, and I'm not done by any means. I consider this, what I'm going into, as my third act. And I said, I have plenty to do. Are you kidding me? There's so much need in this world for those of us with some talent and some, you know, some passion to really make a difference.
Yeah, we're at a time where it really is a tipping point has been reached.
Yep.
And what happens once it tips, then those people who have the most to give to make that change need to step up and be there.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, because this has taken years to get to, and it's nothing like I've ever seen, and it's still going on.
Yes.
Where people are still fighting the fight. And what I'm delighted by is that it's a multicultural coalition. It's not just Black folks marching about Black Lives Matter. I'm stunned at people putting it up on their, you know, on their walls, on their garages, of all races. And so I said, this is the time, and you're right. I hadn't thought of it like, let's bring together all the people that, you know, have something to offer and want to figure out where do we go from here.
There's all types of ways to be a civil rights worker. Now, my son asked me not too long ago, because, well, Mom, did you ever march? And I said, no, Christopher, I had two little boys, and I just didn't think it would be expedient of me to risk my life marching. Not only that, I'm a Californian, and I probably would have been arrested for fighting back or, you know, something like that. So, but my contribution was to show up every day in those jobs that I was the first one to get, and to make sure that people who looked like me got in the door behind me. Because once all the marching stopped, there had to be people there to implement those programs that we said we needed. And if I was there, if I was at the table, they would be implemented in a way that would be effective.
Absolutely. You can't help people without a systematic approach that's business-oriented, that's profitable enough for you to stay in business.
That's right.
And that's the thing. It's really about having candid conversations. I have literally laid off people, but have done it in a way to explain the reasons with the leader and then what the benefits were and what we could do to help them and support them. I have cried with some of them a little bit. And at the end, I get hugs and people telling me that it was the most, you know, sensitively handled prop. You know, so they're thanking me.
Yeah.
Because it's all in... all in your how you can empathize with the person, and it's also about being candid and straightforward.
Right. Yeah, and they need to know the truth. I interviewed a gentleman at Hewlett Packard. He owned a little company back east, and in the process of the interview, he shared with me the fact that he would have to go back and lay off a good number of people from his company, and he was really upset about it. He said, I just don't know how to approach them, and I don't know, because I'm going to disappoint them. I said, what you do is you be as honest as you can. You tell them exactly what you told me, the reason why you have to do this, and they'll understand.
Right.
He got hired on at Hewlett Packard. He had been there maybe a month, and he came by my office, and he said, Kathy, I want to thank you. He said, it was worked beautifully. The minute I told them the reasons, they all understood.
Right.
They were sympathetic with me, and they said, if you ever come back, if you ever start a company again, we'd love to work for you.
Yeah.
Because he had been honest up until that day.
Right, stuff.
So why change your style?
And it's okay to say you're sorry that it's come to this, that this is just a business decision because we have these issues that we're trying to address. And Abbott was one of the most generous companies I've ever worked for. And, you know, I've worked for great companies. I mean, it's like almost, I won't say. But it's very generous.
Yes.
In their, you know, how they treat people when they have to part with them.
Mm-hmm. There was something you didn't talk about, and that was the work you did at Hewlett-Packard.
Well, actually, HP targeted initially college hires and direct hires through the SEED program where we brought them in the summer. 85% of hires for professional jobs were students for several years, and I was a part of helping to put that in place. And it really allowed for people to come in and be groomed into roles and be able to grow in companies, unlike other companies where people bounced around for their next promotion. You know, especially in the high-tech industry, there were no pensions and everybody had 401k, and it was like, okay, where can I go to make more money and get a bigger role instead of being able to be groomed within? And it was so successful that, you know, I still hear from some of the students. But I brought that effort to Apple, too. I helped with our summer hires. At Apple, we had a summer program that I think was initially launched by the Multicultural Programs Department because we wanted to target students of color. So we went to HBCUs and Hispanic schools. And then we would have to put them up, you know, to find housing for them. But I realized that these black kids coming from Tuskegee and FAMU, they didn't get a big response from the majority of the Apple employees. And so I made it a point. Every summer, I had a student live with me. I said, I have to be more committed than just creating a program and hiring them. And then I got others to do that. But I think that companies clearly need to invest more. It's just appalling that, you know, we have students struggling to stay in college because of money issues, and then they graduate with no job to go to. So I also think companies need to do a better job of partnering with education. I think every single company should have a middle school and a high school that they support, that they provide service and materials and books, clean it up. You know, we did that at a middle school. We went in and painted the rooms because the bathrooms had graffiti all over it. You know, and these kids are going to these schools that look like they're in a war zone. So corporate America needs to do a damn better job of supporting education, especially now, because we're not going to be hiring many people from overseas, which was the thing, the HB1 visas. And I just think that's one of the areas of passion for me, too, is working with students and companies. And I always thought that might be a neat program to implement, adopt a school kind of thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Let me thank you not only for your service to the community and to particularly the black community, and also thank you for giving me your time today and sharing your thoughts. Thank you, Teresa, for sharing your love of language and life with us. Your career has taken many paths. As you say, this is just another beginning. Thank you for letting KC Digital Storyteller be a part of that awakening. And thank you for listening.